treatment part is a major way of how you can get in trouble if you get in too big a hurry to get the end result of what you want in terms of prophylaxis and reconstruction. Sometimes that interferes with a few percentage points of survival. Breast exam. How have you been told to do breast exam? What?
Next week?
Yeah. All right. I'll give you my biases on breast exam. Super all rubber or firmer, obviously that's a lot. The sort of soft rubber ball stuff, you gotta, you know, you need to be able to image through it and know it's okay, and if not, you need to worry about that. That's the asymmetric thickness thing. And expressible fluid at the nipple. Expressible fluid at the nipple, greater than 5 years since the last lactation or pregnancy, doubles the risk of being diagnosed with breast cancer in the next decade. So an often missed part of the breast exam is seeing if you can express fluid at the nipple, because that tells you if there's an increased risk in the short term. All right. The breast has tent cords, we call them Cooper's ligaments, but they're conical-shaped tent cords of fibroblasts and fibrous tissue that help to hold it in its shape. When you have an invasive breast cancer and you get an immunologic response to that breast cancer, you will recruit the local fibroblasts, i.e. living on the Cooper's ligaments, into a serous response to the cancer, trying to wall the cancer up like a splinter. As it does that, it's going to foreshorten the Cooper's ligaments, which means if the skin does not float freely over the breast mound and is a little more adherent over something that's a little funny to feel, that's much more suspicious than when the skin flows freely. Benign things like fibroadenoma may feel like a super ball, but they roll around and they're not tethered to anything. But breast cancers is going to be the tethering of the tent cords. So moving the arm around and looking, making sure the skin moves freely is an important part, probably one of the most important and often missed portions of the exam. Looking for it needs to float like a sheer curtain on a windy day in Oklahoma. It needs to float freely over the chest. So that's flattening, a little bit of flattening, a little bit of dimpling. Those are very, foreshortening of the ducts can be important. There is a phenomenon of nipple retraction as you get older. So some women who've had low-grade mastitis or low-grade infections when they were nursing, if they get postmenopausal weight gain and get a lot of ptosis in the breast, the ducts stay the same length and the nipple stays in the same place, but everything else droops, which means they get inverted nipples. That's not really nipple inversion, that's just gravity. Nipple inversion is when they're foreshortened because something's pulling from behind. So sorting that out and getting a good history of that aspect is good. Let's see. I told you the two corners to watch out for and right behind the nipple, because they're never on screen mammogram. Those are your big ones. And hemocult positivity, first shown in 1940. The hemocult positivity was associated with breast cancer and associated with historically 7 to 9% risk of underlying breast cancer. Now that we have sub-millimeter endoscopes to go down the breast, that risk is as high as 18% in the endoscopic series. So we can find breast cancers 10 to 100 the size that you can see on mammogram with a sub-millimeter endoscope. That technology is still evolving, so it's still new. So my bias, mostly because I look at mammograms all the time, I only ever examine a woman upright. C CC and MLO compression. So I can translate what I feel in my hand with what's seen on the mammogram. So if something's in the area you can't see through on the mammogram, can I feel through it carefully? If I can't, and I'm worried, they're high risk, I'll do some other imaging to go with it. But examining women laying flat, oftentimes the breast falls to the side, lower outer quadrant, things move a lot, so you can't choose position on that exam and say where it's going to be on the MLO and CC view. So there's the problem. You need to be able to take your exam and the images and get something meaningful out of it. So that's why I prefer upright. And the reason CC of an MLO was chosen is you can thin the breast out mostly in that direction. Those two directions, so that's a good thing. They can buy manual exams. I provided data on the lecture notes about physical exam. There was a small benefit of adding physical exam onto imaging, but in asymptomatic women, in symptomatic women, physical exam is 50% finds the cancer, and imaging 50% finds the cancer. So symptomatic changes in favor of physical exam being an important component, whereas in asymptomatic. It's only going to marginally affect a small group, and it'll affect the highest risk women more than it affects the family. And contrary to popular belief, compression mammography was developed by a female. It was not developed by a male doctor. Most of our biopsies are core biopsies now, so we use needles that have sampling trays about 1.5 to 2 centimeters in length. They used to be automated things that would take independent cores. Now they go in, turn vacuum on, and nibble away at something. So you can actually take something out about the size of a dime if you sit there long enough with a nibbling thing. So it's not quite accurate enough to do lumpectomy with yet, but obviously you can envision some sort of biopsy device eventually being good enough to do lumpectomy on small tumors. Do you have any questions?
No.
Cancer. Facts and figures. New estimated cases. Go to your breast. See, 250,000 cases. This is going to be invasive breast cancers in the U.S. a year. In men, roughly 2,500. So the treatment, male breast cancer is exactly the same as this female breast cancer. No difference whatsoever in terms of treatment. Just doesn't happen as often. You're often told about male breast cancer, there's increased risk with gynecomastia. That's repeated in a lot of medical textbooks, but there's not really good evidence for that. And in fact, gynecomastia peaks, say, late teens, early 20s, and then peaks again about 65 to 67, or quote, male menopause period. Breast cancer tends to increase with age, so it's going to increase after about age 60. And then, here we go for Oklahoma, 18,000 cases, 2,690 cases of breast cancer in Oklahoma. So we'll have about 40,000 breast cancer deaths a year in the United States total. And half of those breast cancer deaths could be triple negative breast cancer. Could be that bad act. See, deaths in Oklahoma from breast cancer should be around 200. Female breast cancer should be 530 a year. So we actually actually have more deaths from colorectal. So the four most common malignancies, which are breast, prostate, lung, and colorectal, breast is the most curable of them. Prostate tends to be late in life, so life expectancy catches up with you before death. Here we go, SMU cancers. And let's see, probability of developing breast. Birth to 49, 1 in 52. Birth to death, 1 in 8. Breast cancer. If you talk about in situ cancers added in, it's 1 in 6. If you talk about in situ, atypical hyperplasias, and that's just 1 in 3. So most women, the average woman will have it with 3.5 breast biopsies in a lifespan. Pretty common. Pretty common thing. So, thank you.
Yeah. I'm not sure if you said this or not, but is there a genetic marker for male, for women who have the BRCA gene?
BRCA2 has a slightly higher incidence of male breast cancer. And P10 and some of the Lynch-Nyhan mutations, which are you associate more with colorectal stuff, also have a slight increase for male breast cancer. So those are the big ones that stand out. Cowden's disease a little bit.